I'm about to explode.
Holy shit! Yo, I'm out.
You wanna play 21? It's time to let the mud fly, time to identify, it's time to get rolled up. 10 minutes certified, it's time to get rolled up. Cover your eyes, yeah, it's time to get rolled up. Deku Slate.
Welcome to the first episode of DSW Wednesday Night Dekumite. This wrestling-based variety show covers games, pay-per-views, facts and fiction alike, and whatever else. For the first episode, I wanted to take a look at a game that had a big role in my childhood. Many wrestling fans can list a favorite wrestling video game of theirs. For some, it's SmackDown Here Comes the Pain, while for others, it may be something like Virtual Pro Wrestling 2. WCW NWO Revenge, anyone? To a later generation, WWE 13 and 2K14 are classics, while WWE 2K22 has stood as the best Visual Concepts era game so far. But for me, there's just one game that I can put on, whether emulated or on console, that can take me back to a simpler time. WWE SmackDown vs. Raw 2007, released on PlayStation 2, Xbox 360, and PlayStation Portable in 2006, is my all-time favorite wrestling game. Before I get into the game itself, can I just say how amazingly strange this release lineup is? This game came out 7 days before the PS3 and 9 days before the Wii. So the next gen release was 360 exclusive, and the only portable option was the PSP, as Yuke's wouldn't make an SVR game for the DS until SmackDown vs. Raw 2008. This game is the 8th SmackDown title and the 3rd SmackDown vs. Raw title. And of course, it is the first game to come out on the, at the time, next gen. Unfortunately, the game is not backwards compatible on the Xbox One, and I do not own an Xbox 360 currently, so I'll just be focusing on the PS2 version specifically. This was the version I grew up with anyway, so it's quite fitting. Inserting the disc and waiting for the game to read our memory cards, and after the developer logos, were met with either the Raw or SmackDown intros in a random pick. God, the nostalgia. There's something magical about these specific eras, these exact time periods in the company's history being preserved for all eternity thanks to this game. Following the intro screen, you're met with the title screen and that oh-so-amazing soundtrack. God, nostalgia's a hell of a drug, and this game's soundtrack is the supplier. In case you've not heard it before, or you just want to jam out, here's a sample of the songs. So
I got money in the bank, yeah. Shout out what you drink. Maybe in a new life,
Once hitting the start button, you're met with an option to look at tutorial videos. As it turns out, this game plays quite differently from the previous games in the SmackDown series, which I'll get into later on. And so you can either watch the videos on how to play the game, or you can tough it out as the second option displayed. You can also select these videos, of which there are three, whenever from the options menu. The videos are cheesy with use of clip art and a film countdown, along with using different wrestler themes and a narration that reminds me of Bruce Campbell in the Spider-Man games.
Smack the yellow off your opponent's teeth.
You follow me? Well, stop following me or I'll have you arrested.
Alright, well, if I'm going to talk about how the game is differently controlled, I might as well talk about the gameplay. Following in SmackDown vs. Raw 2006's footprint, 07 slows gameplay down from the arcade-style mayhem of the first half of the series. This game adds more realism and, for the first time ever, actively relies on the analog sticks for controls, with the D-pad being relegated to taunting. Now, you can change this in the options, but quiet you! This is how the people at Yukis's and Flux wanted you to play the goddamn game! Controls in general are quite different from the games before it. Strikes are with square or X, your context button for entering, exiting the ring, picking up weapons, etc. are done with cross or A, running is still with triangle or Y, and circle or B has become the button to press to regain your stamina, a system introduced in SV06 and a system that no one should ever like. You still reverse strikes and grapples with L2 and R2 respectively, and targeting, if turned on, is done with the select button. But wait, how do you perform grapples? Well, you remember how I said that controls were changed to have an emphasis on the analog sticks? Yeah, I did not just mean this for movement, as now the right analog stick is exclusively your home for grapple attacks. This may seem like a weird or confusing change from the face button plus direction style of grapples, but honestly, I like the system a lot more. You have snappier grapples on default that don't have you locking up before selecting one, as well as strong grapples done by holding R1 or RB and flicking the analog stick, which does cause a lockup to happen, similar to the Aki games or Day of Reckoning. To me, running grapples feel a lot better here than in other games. That's not the only addition though, as this game features an all-new control style called Ultimate Control. Getting your opponent in a strong grapple allows you to drag the opponent with the left analog stick, but clicking the right stick in causes you to pick up your opponent in a position where you have even more moves to choose from. These positions include a fireman's carry, a cradle, a press slam, a choke slam, and more. Each carry has at least two options to do different moves, and the system also includes context areas such as the ropes, ring posts, barricade, and more. I really enjoy this system as it adds more realism and control in the player's hand. Who doesn't want to pick someone up in a chokeslam as the Undertaker and walk around the ring for a bit? This system would be discontinued in one of the future installments of the series, but a similar carry system would be brought back in the 2K series starting with Dota 2K18. I do like the system there to an extent, but it's not as great as the old system in my opinion, and hell, trying to do something like a Hell in a Cell spot with a carry system takes like 8 years on Dota 2K22. This game also adds back crowd fighting. Well, kinda. There's a spot in the arena with some interactive environment, some tables and weapons, as well as a structure to jump off of. It's not all too much, but it's a welcome addition, considering the last time you could even fight in the crowd was Dirt AF SmackDown Just Bring It. We'll come back to the gameplay itself in a bit, but god, I can't not talk about this roster any longer. While the previous games felt kind of weird, with the loss of guys like the Dudley Boys, Brock Lesnar, Goldberg, and an influx of new talent that WWE wasn't utilizing correctly, the game has, in my opinion, a very strong roster. The game does not include the ECW brand, as it was only started in the summer of 06, not even close to enough time to start adding new guys in, but who we do have is just a stacked roster of guys in their prime. John Cena and Edge, fresh from their rivalry. The faces of SmackDown, Batista and The Undertaker. The goddamn wrestling machine himself, Kurt Angle, in that I'm gonna murder you black attire. Money in the Bank winner, Rob Van Dam. Legend killer, Randy Orton. Plus, you had game debuts for a huge roster of talent like Bobby Lashley, Finlay, Super Crazy, and more. This game also marks the last appearances of Kurt Angle for 11 years and Chris Benoit forever. The game also features return appearances of Matt Hardy and Mark Henry. Notably, this is also the first game to feature Eddie Guerrero as a legend after his tragic 2005 passing. Actually, touching on the Legends roster, there's some great talent. The free faces of Foley, along with the man himself in the normal roster, Bam Bam Bigelow, Hulk Hogan, Jerry Lawler, the original Hart Foundation, Mr. Perfect, Roddy Piper, Shane McMahon, Stone Cold, and The Rock, and even Taz! Now, some of these guys can look a bit rough, particularly Dusty Rhodes, who looks, oh dear God, that's not! No, you can't do that to the American Dream! My eyes! This game also has quite a number of good arenas. 2006 was a great year for pay-per-view sets, my favorite being One Night Stand, Vengeance, SummerSlam, Unforgiven, Taboo Tuesday, Armageddon, New Year's Revolution, Royal Rumble, WrestleMania 22, and Saturday Night's Main Event. Now, there are some minor things, like the ECW One Night Stand arena isn't in Hammerstein, something that wouldn't be emulated until WWE 2K18. And the Judgment Day arena doesn't have that weird sign that was above the ring, which wouldn't be seen until WWE 2K22. But other than that, and maybe a couple other details, all these arenas look really good. They even have the whole Titantron structure working from WrestleMania 22, which I always thought was a super cool stage piece. Alright. How the game plays and presentation is all one thing, but we need to talk about replayability. And man, does this game have quite a lot of it. There is only one new match type, but damn if it isn't an important one. Like Here Comes the Pain being the first game with an elimination chamber, here is SVR 2007 with the other big Ruthless Aggression era match type, Money in the Bank. This match is just such chaotic fun. Six dudes, a bunch of ladders, and one briefcase. I don't think I have to explain why Money in the Bank is so amazing, but man, it just is. One new match type means that we can get into the real meat of this game. Let's start with the season mode. This season mode goes back to the story-by-story style that Here Comes the Pain had, rather than the more linear storytelling SVR 06 had. I like this more because it creates more opportunity for replayability, with a more random chance to get storylines in differing orders. You also get specific storylines for being specific wrestlers and meeting specific requirements, and will be locked out of others, such as Legend's End, which you can't get if you're either playing as Mick Foley or Roddy Piper, or you're holding a title. This is pretty neat stuff, and gives a reason to play through the season mode over and over again with different wrestlers. The reverse of this, however, comes in the fact that some storylines can just repeat again and again. Mainly the first Raw and SmackDown storylines, taking on the show and the Wolverine and the Deadman, these storylines will play pretty much every time you pick someone depending on what brand they're on. And I'm really sick of being grouped in with these jobbers or getting in between SmackDown's top talent when I just turn a new season over. And yes, this is the storyline with the scary Undertaker production, that everyone has talked about to death already. Let's just move past that. A really cool addition to this is something that was teased in SVR 06 but didn't get fully fleshed out until here, and that's a full-on locker room for your wrestler. Now, this isn't so much a locker room as it is just a suite, but I'd much rather have that because this suite is fully customizable from the stairs to the desks, the color of this bar, the color of the lights, and I get to put up a bunch of standees and posters of the divas like a real creep. You sick freak! Here's my locker room from my actual memory card save that I've had for years. Red eyes, just keep my heart green, your secret safe with me. Just drive a sick freak! Outside of season mode, your locker room is also accessible anytime for the main menu, which is nice because it makes everything in the mode actually, you know, worthwhile to collect and customize. If I'm going to spend 2,038 bucks to purchase Chloe, then damn it, I want to look at Chloe anytime I want. Alright, season mode is certainly a mode that people love about these games, and it's fun here, but it's not as often talked about as the next mode here. That's right, it's time for GM mode. After making its debut in the previous game, GM mode is back. Draft a roster, build your shows, and go head-to-head with the other brand, played by an AI or the other player. Man, why don't they bring this mode back? Oh, wait. Well, my GM may exist, and hey, it's pretty good after the update that brought in tag titles, but it definitely isn't as detailed as GM mode. I mean, hey, at least 07 actually has mid-card titles as well. There's also actual rivalry storylines, of which you must purchase the contracts of storyline writers for. As the weeks move on, you can look at the Power 25 rankings to see who is the top of either your brand or of WWE. When it comes to signing guys, you pick different months worth of contracts, which also change the weekly salary. And there's just so much to do in these modes. I don't even think I could cover everything without doing heavy back and forth research between the game and writing and the game and writing. And if you're ever lost or want to report on how you're doing, well, you can look at the JRR Taz reports, depending on your brand. GM mode is a mode that I and many others have gone back to again and again. And it's a mode that people petitioned for years alongside the Universe mode, and sometimes even replacing Universe. Now, I actually believe these modes are perfect together rather than one over the other, because they aren't necessarily the exact same. One is a management sim like that of a tycoon game where you book your shows, look after your talent, and try to beat out the competition, whereas the other mode is a sandbox of booking straight shows of whatever you want, setting up things how you like, which actually has its roots in the final featured game mode, pay-per-view mode. Now, pay-per-view mode is pretty much the same as it's been for the SmackDown series up to this point. In fact, it's kind of weaker than before, because back in the SmackDown 2 days, there were actual ratings of your show. But it's still fun to put together a supercard or recreate a real-life pay-per-view or whatever. There were sample pay-per-views as well, which were all based on the 2005 to 2006 pay-per-views up to that point. There's really not much else to talk about with this mode, so here's a look at some of my custom pay-per-views. You know, this game is quite good, but it certainly isn't perfect. There's some easy exploits, like simulating season mode on Legend difficulty for quick money, or a whole exploit that creates an easy win for GM mode, which by the way are very useful considering the game forces you to purchase championships you create and gain experience points to level up any call you have. God, I do not miss those parts of the game. There's also quite a number of glitches. Simple things like some moves not connecting properly, improper audio callouts, and just whatever else. The worst of it is the Saturday Night's Main Event Arena. For whatever reason, and at least on the PS2 version, and at least on the copy that I own, the commentary is just completely broken. You'll be hitting a suplex or a clothesline just for JR to go, "Austin with a stunner! Stunner!" And you'll just be sitting there like, what? How could I forget the Create modes? There's the aforementioned Create a Championship. There's, of course, Create a Wrestler and Create an Entrance. Hey look, Advanced Entrance, what a novel concept. There's also Create a Moveset and Team. Man, you know what I think of when I think of this game? Homer Simpson. Yeah, I know, that sounds really weird. But these videos right here are the earliest wrestling game videos I ever saw on YouTube. It's up there with the Uber Hacks or Nova SVR 2011 series and the early CM Pulse videos for just giving me absolute nostalgia. And that's pretty much it for this game. Now, there's also online, but that's probably inaccessible, and you can replay these modes to your heart's content, or just play exhibition matches on your own, or with friends. Or, you could waste the rest of your life playing challenge mode. That's right, challenge mode. What started from the original SmackDown vs. Raw as exhibition challenges has now become its own mode of 31 challenges. Now, I won't go through all of them, and as a matter of fact, a number of these challenges are so easy and forgettable they aren't even worth going through, but I will say that 15 challenges are first accessible for the Superstar challenges. Competing all of these will unlock the Legend challenges, which are definitely harder in difficulty, and upon completing the 15 challenges here, you unlock the final challenge, but hold on. 14 of the 15 Legend challenges, while ranging in difficulty, are still all pretty much completable. But there is one. Oh, there is one. Harder than the high overall filled elimination chamber. Harder than Mexicools versus Brothers of Destruction. It's personality disorder.
You're not mentally prepared to do this.
I'm not mentally prepared to do this at all. Christ, run, run, run. Oh God, I forgot. The steps over there are like ass. Hold on.
He's gonna go.
No. They do this, look at this. They fucking do this, dude. It's the worst. And then you can't leave. If they get close enough to you, you're done for.
This is all I love.
Run! No!
Pile driver. Yeah, you can't. Oh, fuck. He reversed. No!
I used to be so good at this game, I would eventually. What are you talking about? Alright. Yes! Please. No! He reversed it. Of course he's dead. No. Get him! No! No! No, anything but Socko. It's over. Get me out of here! Did you see that? Cactus, wait! Yo!
You did the blue job.
No, you know what? I'm not going for the pile driver. I'm just gonna continue using the stairs.
Maybe you should have got a pile driver.
Drop it. No, you dick. You fucking dick.
It sounds crazy, but I know exactly what you're talking about. It's like a split personality thing or something.
Oh, yeah. It's almost like it's personality disorder, Taz. Fuck you. Red Hook. I gotta get in here. Hold up. Hey, guys. Hold on. Can you... No! Why did I... I had the win. Oh my god. I don't care. Jack's getting up in my... Come on. Yes!
He's an idiot. He got distracted by the stairs.
Oh my god.
And just when you think it's all done, that you finally finished one of the hardest challenges ever, dear god, you unlocked the tester challenge. Mickey James versus the Great Khali. Legend difficulty, no ring out. There's actually a piece of gameplay that I didn't mention at all, and that's that there's this absolutely god-awful weight detection balancing, of which makes the Great Khali the only wrestler known as an ultra heavyweight. They gave the Great Khali his own weight class so that he could no-sell and not be lifted by pretty much the entire roster. Pair that with the featherweight Mickey James and, yeah, this challenge sucks. I'll be perfectly honest with you, I just went into the settings and turned down all the sliders to win the challenge. Because, hey, it's not cheating if you're using the tools the game gave you. Oh, and you don't even get a special trophy or even a special load screen or anything. You literally get some cash. The completed text next to the challenge and an empty soul. SmackDown vs. Raw 2007 does mean a lot to me. And I go back to the game often, even if it's just to play one or two matches on my own, or to play with friends. The memories I have of just sitting around grinding out the season mode, or spending hours looking at KOF formulas and making guys, or just making my own KOFs. It's a great game, and to many is the end of an era, as the follow-up year's title was, well, it was SVR 2008. Maybe that game will be for another time, but until then, with the first episode of DSW Dekumite out of the way, I hope you enjoyed it. Next week, we will be looking at another key point of nostalgia of mine, but what it is, exactly, will be saved for next time. Make sure to like the video if you did like it, and subscribe for more weekly wrestling content and whatever the hell I decide to make. And if you want to really support the channel and what I make, head on over to my Patreon, which I just opened. It's nothing special right now, although I will be updating it and maybe doing some Patreon exclusive content based on how many patrons I do end up getting. But until then, this is Deku Slate, signing off.